So if for whatever reason, we're not gonna have to jump out of the plane, but if for whatever reason we do have to jump out
of the plane. You're getting this, right? That's me, learning how to jump out of a plane, specifically that plane. But before we get to that, let me back up. So I recently went to Vermont to visit this company called Beta.
Ta-da!
And they've gotten a lot of attention recently because they're building a new kind of airplane. Not this one, but this one. And the thing that's so cool about the plane that they're building is it's electric.
The electric aircraft.
An electric vehicle takeoff and landing aircraft.
Combination of a helicopter and a plane.
Now, when I think of electric airplanes, I think of those like tiny two-seater, like toy-looking things. Like, very cool, but very small. I thought that the problem was the weight of batteries meant that electric airplanes just like weren't gonna be that useful for a really long time. But the thing I forgot is that we've gotten a lot better at making batteries. All of those gains mean that electric airplanes are now starting to do more and more, and that's a really big deal. You already know that air travel is bad for the environment, but just look at this. This shows how, just within our grandparents' lifetime, air travel has dumped more and more CO2 into our atmosphere. But also, just within that same lifetime, think about how air travel has transformed us. It's not just trade and transportation, it's like how we understand each other and the world. So we're in this moment where one of the most important innovations in human history is on a direct collision course with our future. We've got to make better planes. And now, we might have the tools to do it. So in this video, we're going to talk about the effort to build the future of airplanes. Where we are now, where we're headed, and where we've been. That last part is the reason why I needed a parachute. And also a helmet. Because while I couldn't actually fly in one of those electric planes, I can give you some aviation history in the most YouTube way possible.
Up front?
Oh yeah, yeah, you gotta be up front.
Excellent.
But here's the really key part, the part that gets me most excited. Building better planes isn't just an opportunity to reduce carbon emissions. It's also a chance to rethink planes themselves.
In the future, electric vertical takeoff and landing aircraft.
Electric vertical aircraft.
Electric aircraft.
The future of aviation.
I'm here to visit a very cool electric plane company.
The idea of electric aviation didn't start with climate change. Before airplanes, there were airships. Just like, look at these crazy sky whales. And some of those were electric. Here's one in 1883. This thing used a nearly 1,000-pound battery made from zinc and chlorine. But the more we flew, the more clear it became that batteries were too big and heavy to compete with burning liquid fuel, which is the problem that we've been trying to solve ever since.
Why don't we go to the battery study hall project? So what you can see at the very simplest level is the lithium ion cell. And 18 of those cells are arranged in parallel to give us our basic building block of our battery pack. We take 14 of those battery modules and we arrange those in series. And now we end up with one battery pack. These batteries are the same lithium ion cells that are used in a Tesla. So one of our battery packs right here has the same amount of energy that is in your standard Tesla car right now.
Okay, let's say you were trying to build an airplane. You've got two big ways to figure out how much energy you can store in a battery. Either volumetric, which is how much energy you can store in comparison to its size, or gravimetric, which is how much energy you can store in comparison to its weight. This is also called the specific energy. If you were building your plane in 2010, you would have needed this much space to output the same amount of energy as the average aviation fuel. And it would have had to weigh a whopping 50 times more. Plus, you'd have to consider the other factor here, which is when you fly in a fuel plane, you are burning the fuel as you fly, which means it gets lighter, and batteries don't. But in the last decade, batteries have gotten a lot smaller. And, crucially for planes, they've gotten lighter. You saw this happen. You saw it in your laptops, in your phones, in your electric cars. We're all a part of this story without even realizing it. And now, all of that innovation, that's being applied to electric planes. And it's important to understand this isn't just innovation in making the individual batteries themselves better. It's also innovation in how densely we can pack them together. But, no matter how you measure it, batteries are still far from fuel. But it's also not as though anyone's waiting for this moment to start building things. They're using what they already have. And what they already have is really cool.
We're using commercial off-the-shelf lithium ion cells. And what I think is awesome about that is it shows what we're doing is real, it's here today, and it's achievable.
And maybe the most important factor in making it real and achievable, just look how much cheaper batteries have gotten. Okay, so all of this together means there's been this huge new wave of investment in electric planes. And along the way, we're redesigning what a plane looks and feels like. Beta's new electric plane is already flying around, but I am extremely not allowed inside it. I tried. But instead, I'm gonna show you what it's like in a different way. This is a real cockpit of a Beta plane that they built inside of a simulation to train new pilots, or me.
You have two different types of flight controls. Attitude is in your right hand, okay, and power is in your left hand.
This is gonna be a fun video game.
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm not very good at video games, just to clarify.
But are you good with attitude?
I have it.
And I want you to just focus on raising the lift lever until the aircraft starts to hover. You did it.
Now what?
Let go of everything. And I want you to notice how stable the aircraft is.
Yeah, is this similar to real life?
It is.
Wow.
This is real physics.
At this point, you've probably noticed that this plane is not taking off like a normal plane. It's a vertical takeoff and landing. This isn't because it's electric, but the innovations work together. Electric batteries are heavier, but electric motors are actually lighter and smaller, so you have more options for where you put them on the plane. Here's roughly where the engines are on a big fuel passenger plane that you might take, versus a smaller fuel plane, versus an electric one. A very cool thing about trying so hard to build new kinds of planes is you get to rethink planes.
There's a lot of places that we can't get with conventional aircraft. Vertical takeoff and land is going to open up aviation to places that just simply don't have an airport. So you push that, there you go. And you see these propellers stow. You are now a single engine aircraft. So we're going to have you land this aircraft. This is perfect, Cleo.
I'm about to land.
You're about to land. And nobody touched a single control but you.
There she is.
It's not very often I'm able to teach one of these and not have to help.
Really?
So you did a wonderful job.
Thank you.
Okay, so these planes are awesome, but they're just not gonna replace the like big fuel passenger planes that you might be used to anytime soon. But the thing is, the really important piece to understand here is in order to make a huge difference, they don't have to. If the goal is reverse this skyrocketing emissions problem, and electric planes can only go fairly short distances, what we really need to know is what percentage of the emissions from aviation are from long versus short flights. No problem. Turns out you need to first break up flights into passenger versus freight, so us versus our stuff. And then within passenger flights, a third of emissions come from short-haul flights, which are defined as less than 1,500 kilometers or 932 miles. That's a lot. But there's some debate on how far exactly electric planes can go, and there's a whole problem with charging and how long people would wait to charge or freight would wait to be charged. But here's where it gets even better. If you break down emissions into even smaller chunks, the percent emissions actually look like this. Really short flights account for more emissions because the extra fuel used on takeoff is a greater percentage of the flight compared to cruising, and because we often use less efficient planes on short flights. So if you electrify these, you can make a real dent even before you get to all of this. And then there's all of the freight, all of our stuff. This is what Beta is actually focusing on. Freight is super interesting because there's a chance, especially with vertical takeoff and landing, that you can actually also reduce carbon emissions from a totally different source outside of aviation. It's probably one of the reasons why UPS just signed a big deal with Beta. I don't know for sure, but I imagine that one of the big questions they're thinking about is, if you didn't have to rely on roads, how would delivery change? The point is, electric planes can help move us into the future without waiting to start in the future. So at the end of my visit to Beta, we talked about the future of airplanes, we'd seen all of this cool stuff, and they were like, do you wanna see how far we've come? And I was like, yeah, of course. Like, do you wanna do it in a 1940s airplane?
You wanna go upside down, don't you?
I'm gonna go upside down in an open cockpit plane.
Oh yeah.
I didn't know you were allowed to do that.
Oh yeah, we are.
I said yes. I didn't tell my parents until afterward though. Sorry, Mom and Dad.
Listen, if I don't come back, you want to upload these video files to the Dropbox.
So that is a 1942 Stearman. It is a primary World War II trainer. Okay.
How do I prevent the camera from going flying when I go upside down? You know what's really cool? So from here, in my seat in this 1940s airplane, I can see the electric planes that they're building that are going to come next.
Here's the thing that really blows my mind. When my grandfather was my age, this plane was state of the art. Like right around here somewhere, before all of this. Just think about everything that we've accomplished in aeronautics since then. Like if we can do all of that, can we do something like this? We're facing these big challenges, right? Environmental, financial, technological, but I just keep thinking, could my grandfather have imagined the planes that he would see in his 90s? And the ways that we would use them? Bet you we can't either.